Welcome to our YouTube channel, Knowledge Academy. Today we are going to discuss about the 10 numerical problems of the network theory, and this is the third lecture in this playlist. If you have not seen the previous two lectures, then please kindly go to the playlist of Get Previous Year Questions. If you like the content of this lecture, then please like, share and subscribe with your friends in the social media group. So now let's get started. So now we will discuss about the from 21st question. The question says about the, we will discuss about the concepts regarding the coupling factor. So right now we will discuss everything about the coupling factor. So coupling factor is denoted by the symbol K. Coupling factor is denoted by the symbol K. So M is equal to, M means mutual inductance. M is a symbol of the mutual inductance, and K is nothing but the coupling factor. K means coupling factor, and we will know about the another term. L means self inductance. So M means mutual inductance, K means coupling factor, and L means self inductance. So we have to know the relation between this among these three terms. So M is equal to K into root over L1 and L2. This is the relation between the three terms, which are M, mutual inductance between the coils, and K, coupling factor, and L1 is the self inductance of the coil 1, and L2 is the self inductance of coil 2. So suppose this is a common core. Suppose this is an iron core. On this iron core, we are placing two coils, which are L1. This is one coil, and there is another coil. So these are the coils 1 and 2. As the coils have inductance properties, which is denoted by the symbol L1, and the other coil has an inductance property, which is denoted by the symbol L2. So K means coupling factor. Suppose if K is equal to 0, it means isolated coils. If K is equal to 0, it is called as the isolated coils. Means this indicates that there is no relation between the flux going from this coil is not linking with this coil. I am repeating again. The flux, whenever there is a current is passing through the coil 1, it produces a flux in this coil. So the flux produced by this coil is not linking with the other coil. That is what it is saying. Suppose K is equal to 1, it means tightly coils. Means the 100% flux produced by this coil is linking with this coil. Means there is 100% linking. The same flux, whatever the produced by this coil, is always passing through this coil also. That is why it is called as a tightly coils. When K is equal to 0, isolated coils means the flux produced by this coil is not passing through this coil. Means there is no linkage. The flux between this and this, there is no linkage. It means we can assume like this, it is present on one coil and one core, and it is present on other core. This is the coil is present here, and the coil is present here. This is L1, this is L2. So whatever the flux produced is always defined in this specific region. And the flux produced by this coil is defined only through this specific region. So there is no linkage between these two coils. That is why it is called as isolated coils. Now, in place of K is equal to 1, means there are 1 as if they are present on one of each other. It means this is L1 and the other one is in black and drawing. So there is a tightly coupled. Means whatever the flux produced by this blue is always linking with the black coil. That is why it is called as a tightly coupled coils. So we can write here tightly coupled coils. So, by these two things, we can easily know that k lies between 0 less than or equal to k less than or equal to 1. So, k can be either 0 or k can be 1. So, the range of k is always lies between 0 less than k less than or equal to 1. So, if we keep this k range in this equation, we will know the range of the mutual inductance. So, when k is equal to 0, let me write here. Suppose when k is equal to 0, if I place k is equal to 0 in this equation, we will get m is equal to 0. Implies m is equal to 0. Suppose k is equal to 1, the maximum value of k is 1. If I place this k is equal to 1 in this equation, then m will be root over m is equal to root over L1, L2, which is the minimum value. So I can write here minimum value. Mutual inductance minimum value is 0. And here mutual inductance maximum value is root over L1, L2. So I can write like this equation, 0 less than or equal to M less than or equal to root over L1, L2. So finally, I am trying to tell you that so, 0 less than or equal to k less than or equal to 1. Then, m will be 0 less than or equal to m less than or equal to root over L1, L2. This question has given in the previous year yet. That is why I have told you briefly the concept of this concept. Now, after solving the 21st question, we will move forward to solve the another question, which is 22nd. This problem is given in GATE in 2001 for 1 mark. So, this question is given in GATE 2001 year for 1 mark. The question says that there are two bulbs. One is 40 watt rating and the other is 60 watt rating. I am repeating again. There are two bulbs. One bulb is 40 watt rating and the another bulb is 60 watt rating. These two bulbs are connected in series across a supply. And they are connected in series across a supply. He is asking which bulb will glow brighter. So we have to figure in these two bulbs which bulb will glow more brighter. So that is what we need to figure out in this problem. So let's get started and solve this problem. See, we know the power equation. Power is equal to I square R, or we can write V square by R, or we can write V into I. These are the three terms we have to remember. So, suppose this is supply voltage V. So, we can assume these are also defined across a same identical voltage. Means for this bulb it has a reading of power is equal to 40 watt and the voltage is V. The rated voltage is V. Assume like that. In the second bulb also the power is 60 watt and assume it has a rating of voltage V as the same voltage across the supply. So now see here. For the bulb 1, I assume this as the first bulb and the other as second bulb. So, first bulb. I am analyzing the first bulb. See here, P is equal to V square by R. V square by R. P is, suppose this is a 40 watt. Power is a 40 watt. So, V square by R, P 40 is the rating of bulb of 40 and the resistance of 40 watt bulb. So, as the V is constant and V is same across the both bulbs, so I can write like this, right? P 40 watt, I am taking this side to the left side into R 40 watt is equal to V square. Similarly, for the second bulb, I can write in a similar fashion, right? P is equal to V square by R. Your P is 60 watt bulb, right? P is 60 watt. And similarly, V square by R 60 watt. Where P 60 watt is the power of the 60 watt bulb, and the R 60 watt is the resistance of the 60 watt bulb. So I am keeping the V square this side, and I am shifting this R 60 watt to the left side. So it will become multiplication. So P 60 watt into R 60 watt is equal to V square. So now I am equating these both equations because V square is common. So P 40 watt into R 40 watt is equal to P 60 watt into R 60 watt, right? I just equated these both equations, so I got like this. Now see here, P 60 is more higher, right? This is lower. 60 watt bulb has more rating than the 40 watt bulb. But these two terms has to be constant. So if one is increases, the other has to be decrease. If other is in this side, one is decreases, means the other has to increase. Then only the product will be constant. So now we can say that 60 watt bulb has less resistance when compared to the 40 watt bulb. I will repeat again. The 60 watt bulb has low resistance when compared to the 40 watt bulb. So resistance of 40 watt is higher than the resistance of 60 watt. This is the final I want to say here. The resistance of 40 watt bulb is higher than the resistance of 60 watt bulb. As this is a series connection, the current is same in both bulbs. As this is a series connection, the current is same through both bulbs, right? So now I have to calculate which bulb glows higher. So P is equal to I square R. So I is constant, so R is a variable. So power across bulb 1 means first bulb is I square into R 40 watt. Similarly, power dissipated across bulb 2 is equal to, as the current is same in both, so that's why I am taking same I square R 60 watt. So now, just now we have known this I is constant in both equations, but resistance of 40 watt is higher than the resistance of 60 watt. So therefore P1 is greater than the P2, means P1 is greater than P2. P1 is greater than P2 because R 40 watt is greater than R 60 watt and I is constant. So finally we can conclude that the bulb 1, which has low rating, glows more brighter when compared to the high rating power when they are connected in series. Again, everybody. The low rating bulb glows more brighter than the high rating bulb in a series connection. So now we will move forward to solve the another question. This question says that it's a three phase load in this. The resistance across the terminals A and B when C is open. The question says that the resistance across the A and B terminals when C is open is 6 ohms. Similarly, the resistance across B and C terminals when the terminal A is open is 11 ohm. And similarly, the resistance across C and A terminals when B is open is 9 ohms. So the aim of this problem is to figure out the resistance of RA, RB, RC. And this question is given in the GATE 2001 for 2 marks. So this is our main aim, to find RA, RB, RC in this problem. So now let's get started and solve this problem. So there is given that the resistance across A and B terminals when C is open, means there is no, then we don't have to consider this terminal C, because only RA and RB are necessary for the calculation of the resistance. So there is no need to take this resistance RC. Therefore, RA plus RB is equal to 6 ohm. Similarly, the resistance across V and C means only these resistance RB and RC are considered, and the resistance RA is negative because this terminal is open. That's why RB plus RC is equal to 11 ohm. And similarly, the resistance across C and A terminal is 9 ohm. So only we need to consider only RC and RA. As the terminal B is open, then we don't need to consider the resistance RB. So RC plus RA is equal to 9 ohm. RC plus RA is equal to 9 ohm. So these are the three equations: equation 1, equation 2, and the equation 3. So now let's add all these three equations, means 1 plus 2 plus 3. So if you do, we'll get RA and RA, it becomes 2RA. Similarly, RB plus RB, it becomes 2RB. Similarly, RC plus RC, it will become 2RC. So 2 of RA plus RB plus RC. Then we need to add 6 plus 11, 17, 17 plus 9, 26. So 26. So RA plus RB plus RC is equal to 13. We know RA and RB. R plus RB is equal to 6 ohm. So therefore RC is equal to 7 ohm. Right? And RB plus RC is equal to 11. Means RB plus RC is equal to 11. So 13 minus 11, 2. So RA is equal to 2 ohm. So if we need to figure only RB, right? So RB. So keep these three, keep these 2, 7 ohm and 2 ohm in this equation. Then we will figure out the another one, RB. 7 plus 2, 9. 13 minus 9, 4. So RB is equal to 4 ohm. So RA is equal to, the answers we got is 2 ohm. And the RB is 4 ohm. And RC is 7 ohm. So the main objective of this problem is to figure out the resistance RA. Okay, now let's move forward to do the another problem. The problem number is 24. And this problem says that there is a circuit like this. There is a circuit like this. In this circuit, there is a resistance, there is a capacitance, and there is a two coils. And the question says this, the circuit is under resonance. The question says that the circuit is under resonance. We need to figure out the value of coupling factor and the dot. The priority of dot, we have to figure out whether it is at terminal P or whether it is terminal Q. So these two things we need to figure out, and this question is given in the GATE examination in the year 2002 for 2 marks. And listen carefully, this problem is very easy. So let us focus more into it to get the exact concept behind it, how to solve it. So let's get started to solve this one. Let us assume that the polarity of this coil, of the second coil, the first coil is given in the question, it is at the left side, it is in the dot. But we need to know exactly where the dot is present, either cross P or cross Q. Let us assume that the polarity of dot of coil 2 is at P. Assume dot is at P. Then it means that if it is at P, if we get M is equal to positive, in our calculation, then our assumption is correct. Suppose if we get m is equal to negative after doing calculation, then our assumption is wrong. If m is equal to positive, then our assumption is correct. It means that the dot is at P. Suppose when we assume dot is at P, if we got m is equal to minus, suppose if we got m is equal to minus, then our assumption is wrong. Then our assumption is wrong. It means the dot is at terminal Q, not at P. So now let's move forward to do it. See here, the question is already says that the circuit is at resonance. Under resonance, the circuit is purely resistance. The circuit is purely resistance means the sum of inductance and the sum of capacitance of total reactance of inductance and capacitance is zero. So the resistance neglect the resistance part, and the whole inductance and capacitance must become short circuit, means zero reactance or zero impedance. So it is the capacitance value is minus J12 plus. Here there are two coils, right? I assumed the coils as the I assumed this coil, coil 1 and coil 2. This polarity is given in the question. I assumed that the dot is at the terminal P, right? So whenever the current is going, it passes through dot in the first coil, and it also passes, it enters the coil 2 across the dot, right? See, I'll repeat again. The current is entering the dot in first coil, and the current is entering the dot in second coil. So this is series aiding. So whenever there is a series aiding, the inductance will increase. So the equivalent inductance is equal to L1 plus L2 plus 2M, where L1 is the inductance of first coil and L2 is the inductance of second coil, where M is the mutual inductance between the two coils, right? So this is the, so I am assuming this is the total equivalent inductance. So the reactance will become omega L equivalent. This is inductance, this is reactance. Equivalent inductance of the total of both the coils. So whenever we always keep like J X equivalent, right? For capacitance we will keep minus J X E. For inductance we will keep plus J X L or J X equivalent. So plus is already written. J X equivalent is equal to 0. So by removing the common J, so otherwise take this to the right side, so it will become XJ equivalent is equal to XJ12. So JJ will keep cancel, X equivalent is equal to 12. X equivalent means what? I have written omega L equivalent. Omega L equivalent is equal to 12. L equivalent is L1 plus L2 plus 2M, right? So omega into L1 plus L2 plus 2M is equal to 12. Omega into L1 plus L2 plus 2M is equal to 12. So omega L1 plus omega L2 plus 2 omega M is equal to 12. See, omega L1 means the reactance of the coil 1. It is 8. So this belongs to, this is 8. Omega L2 means the reactance of the coil 2. It is already given in the question. The reactance is 8. Similarly, H. So 2 omega M. M is the unknown quantity we need to figure out. Is equal to 12, right? So 8 plus 8 is 16. 12 minus 16 minus 4. Minus 4 by 2 minus 2. So omega M is equal to minus 2. Omega M is equal to minus 2. Omega is 2 pi f. omega is 2 pi f. Frequency is always positive. So, omega is also always positive. If omega is positive, then m has to become negative, because minus 2 by positive is, so m has to become negative. So, our answer got m is equal to negative. I already told you in the starting, if we assume dot is at a, if I assume dot is at p, then after calculation we have to get m is equal to positive. But we didn't, then only our assumption is correct. But after calculation we got m is equal to negative. So our assumption is wrong. Means the dot is at not p, but the dot is at present at q. So therefore dot is not present at p. It is into means the dot is not present at P, but in fact the dot is present at Q. So in these two things we figured out the first one, and we need to figure out the another term. We need to figure out the value of the K. K means coupling factor or coupling coefficient. There are two names for this. So we need to figure out the value of K now. So K is equal to, I have already told you in the 21st problem, where k is equal to m by root over L1, L2. K is equal to m by root over L1, L2. So, I will multiply and divide by omega. I will multiply numerator and denominator by the omega. Omega is the angular frequency. So, omega m omega into root over L1, L2. Now, I can write like this, right? Omega m by, if omega, I will take inside. So, it will become omega square, right? Omega L1 into omega L2. See, omega m is equal to minus 2 means when dot is at P. But omega m will become plus 2 when dot is at Q. So we already know the dot is at Q. So omega m is how much? Plus 2. So plus 2 by root over omega L1 means the reactance of the first coil. The reactance of first coil is how much? 8. Omega L2 is the reactance of the second coil. The reactance of second coil is 8. So 2 by root over 8 into 8. So it will become 2 by 8. 2 by 8 means 1 by 4. 1 by 4 means 0.25. So therefore K is equal to 0.25. So finally, we have figured out two unknown parameters, which are K is equal to 0.25 and the dot is at Q but not at P. So if dot is at Q, this will become series opposition. So the inductance will decrease. So the total effect will become, the total capacitance and inductance effect will become zero. And we can figure out the value of K and M. If omega is given, suppose if omega is given in the question, we can figure out the value of M, exact value of M. But in the question, there is not mentioned about the frequency. So we cannot figure out the value of M exactly. Okay. After solving the previous question, now we will move forward to do the another question. The question number is 25. The question says that it is a part of circuit. In this, the voltage across the resistance 5 ohm is 5 volt. It is there in the question. And the voltage across the capacitor, which is 1 farad, is 4 sine 2t. And we need to figure out what is the voltage across the inductance. The main aim of this question is to figure out the value of the voltage across the inductance, which is 2 Henry. This question is given in the GATE examination for 1 mark. So we need to figure out the value of VL. This is our main agenda of this, or objective of this question. See, KCL, it works on the principle of law of conservation of charge. And the KVL, it works on the principle of conservation of the energy. So, see, always the current goes from higher potential to the lower potential, right? So the world, its terminals, polarity is given the question, positive and negative. So the current always goes from higher potential to lower potential. Your higher potential is positive and the lower potential is negative. So the current goes from higher potential to lower potential. So the current is voltage by resistance. So voltage is 5 and the resistance is 5. So 5 by 5 is 1 ohm. See, 1 ampere. So the current is 1 ampere, which is into the junction, right? This is junction. Let us consider this as a junction. And similarly, the 2 ampere is also moving inside the junction, into the junction. And let me consider there is a current through the inductor is also going into the junction, because the current goes from higher potential to the lower potential. And consider the capacitor, see, the polarity is also given. So the current goes from higher potential to lower potential. So the current across the capacitor is also going from higher potential to lower potential. Means from positive polarity to negative polarity. So by KCL, at junction, let me consider this junction. So by KCL across junction, the sum of incoming currents is equal to sum of outgoing currents. But you see in this question, all the currents are entering into the junction. So the total sum of currents into the junction is 0. So the total sum of currents inside. So let me consider 2 ampere and this is 1 ampere and this is IC and this is IL, right? Is equal to 0. 2 plus 1 plus IC plus IL. All these currents are entering into the junction or inside the junction. That's why the sum of each one is 0 by KCL. So now we need to figure, so IC plus IL. So 2 plus 1 is equal to 3. If I move to the right side, it will become minus 3. So IC plus IL is equal to minus 3. Let me consider this as a first equation. And see here, the voltage across the capacitor is 4 sine 2t and the value of the capacitance is 1 farad. So we need to figure out the value of the current IC. If we know the current, then only the unknown parameter is IL. If we know the IL, we can place in place of inductor, the equation of the inductor, then we can easily get the value of the voltage across the inductor. So that is the procedure we need to follow in order to solve this question. So let me first find out the value of the current in the capacitor IC. So the relation of voltage and current in the capacitor is IC is equal to C dV by dt. So IC, the current through the capacitor, is equal to capacitance value into voltage across the capacitor by dt, rate of change of voltage. So IC is already, IC, we need to figure out, right? IC. C is how much? 1 farad. So 1 dVc by dt. So we need to do the differentiation of this. Sine 2t is cos 2t. The differentiation of sine is cos, but 2 is there inside, right? If it goes, if it comes outside, it will become 4 into 2 into cos 2t. So it will become 8 cos 2t. So this is the current in the capacitor. This is the expression of the current in the capacitor, which is 8 cos 2t. So we got the current. Now we need to figure the value of IL. So IL is equal to minus 3 minus IC. So IL is equal to minus 3 minus IC. So keep this value here. We will get IL is equal to minus 3 minus 8 cos 2t. Minus 8 cos 2t. This is the expression of the current in the inductor. So we need to figure out the value of the voltage across the inductor. So VL is equal to L dL by dt, which is the expression, which is the voltage current expression of the inductor. So VL is equal to IL, VL is equal to L dIL by dt. So the value of L is given in the question, which is 2, and we need to do the differentiation of dL by dt. So differentiation of minus 3, which is a constant, is 0. So we need to do the differentiation of this part. So differentiation of cos is minus sign. So minus minus will become positive. Plus positive. Take 8 like same, the same as, write the same 8 here also. So cos is minus sign. So minus minus cancel. So 2 is there inside, right? It will come outside. So 8 into 2 sin 2d. So 8 to the 16, 16 is a 32. So finally, the voltage across the inductor is 32 sin 2d. So we had figured out the value of the voltage across the inductor is 32 sin 2d. So now, after solving the previous question, now let's move forward to do the another question, which is 26th. This question says that it is a figure, it is a circuit in which we need to figure out the voltage PPQ, means the voltage across the terminals P and Q, we need to figure out. So this question is given in GATE 2003 for 2 marks. This question is given in GATE 2003 for 2 marks. We need to figure out the value of voltage PQ, P and Q, means voltage across the terminal P and Q. So VPQ is equal to VP minus VQ. VP minus VQ. This question can be solved very easily by using nodal analysis, because see here, there are actually nodes. First, before using the nodal analysis, first we need to know how many nodes are there in this circuit. So this is a node. In this node there are 3 branches are meeting, right? So here also is a node, because here also 3 branches are meeting, here also 3 branches are meeting. So this is also a node. Here also there is a node, because 3 branches are meeting. So there are totally 4 nodes in this circuit. So out of this 4 circuit, we need to assume one node as a reference node. You can assume any one node irrespective, but finally you will get the same result. If you assume voltage across P, across the node P as a reference, and if you do the calculation, or otherwise you take this point as reference, or you take this point as reference, or you take this point as reference, finally the node voltages may vary according to the value of reference, but the voltage across the branches will remain same irrespective of the node voltage which you have taken as a reference. That is the point I want to say. So let me take this point as a reference, means zero voltage. So the remaining voltage I need to figure out. So out of 4 nodes, 1 node voltage I know by default it is 0 volt. So there are more 3 nodes. These more 3 nodes voltage I need to figure out. But if you see carefully, the out of 3, 1 node is already known, because if it is 0 volt, there is a 10 volt, right? 10 volt means VR. VR minus this potential is 0, right? Is equal to 10. 10 volt, right? The voltage across these 2 terminals is 10. So therefore VR is equal to 10 volt. So out of 4 nodes, two node voltages are already known. So the remaining 2 node voltages we need to figure out, and after that we need to do the difference. VPQ is called VP minus VQ. Then our main agenda of this problem is finished. So we need to figure out the value of voltage P and voltage Q. So now, by using nodal analysis at point A, nodal analysis, I am writing the shortcut NA at point P. At point P, see, sum of outgoing currents is 0. Let me assume the current is going outside here and outside here. 3 branches, so 3 branches, right? So I am assuming all the currents are going outside. So let me write KCL here first. So VP, voltage across the point VP is, so let me assume it is VP. So VP minus 0 by H. So VP minus 0 by H. So one branch is finished and the remaining 2 are there. So VP minus VR is already known, 10. So Vp minus 10 by 2. So current always goes from higher voltage to lower voltage. So Vp minus 10 by 2. Similarly, the last branch is, the current is by default is 2 ampere, right? It is a current source. The value, the current in the current source will be, which is default by the value of the current source, the voltage may vary across the current source. So it is 2 ampere, right? 2 ampere. So if you simplify this, this is an equation with only one unknown. After simplifying this equation, we will get Vp is equal to around 4.8 volts. So Vp is equal to 4.8 volts. So now we need to figure out only the last one, which is Q. So now by nodal analysis at the point Q. So by nodal analysis at point Q. Similarly at point Q also, now remove all these things. I am trying to say all these basics to a person. If he doesn't know also, he can easily understand. If he doesn't know anything also, the main aim of my classes is to, even if first year is seeing these videos, he must also get to understand what I am trying to say. If you are an experienced person, if you have completed a BTEC, then it will be for you, it is just like a revision. Okay, so by nodal analysis at point Q, so all, just assume that all the currents are going outside. So in this branch, Vq minus 0 by 6, because current goes from higher potential to lower potential. Similarly, Vq minus Vr is always by default is 10, right? 10 by 4. And see here, the current outside means the current is coming inside 2. So outside current is negative. So minus 2 is equal to 0. So there is only one equation with one unknown. We have to figure out the value of unknown. So if you do the simplification, you will get Vq is equal to 10.8 volts. So after getting Vp and Vq, we have to figure out the value of Vpq. So Vpq is equal to Vp minus Vq. So after simplifying, if you keep the value of Vp and Vq, if you simplify, you will get Vpq is equal to minus 6 volts. So our main objective of this problem is to figure out the value of Vpq. So we successfully figure out, which is minus 6 volt. So after doing the previous problem, now let's move forward to the another problem, which is the 27th question. The question in this circuit, our main aim of this question is to figure out the value of the resistance R. This question is given in the GATE 2000 year for 2 marks. So this problem is also can be done by the nodal analysis method. This problem can be done by the nodal analysis method. See here, first we need to figure out how many nodes are there in the circuit. See, this is one node and there is another node, so 2. And here is third node. So here is four nodes. Four nodes are there. So we need to figure out the value of resistance R. See here, I am assuming this has a zero potential or ground. So the remaining out of four nodes, one node voltage is 0 volt. So we need to figure out the value of the another 3 node voltages. If you see carefully here, this node voltage is 100 volt. Let me assume this is a voltage Vx, because Vx minus 0 is equal to 100. So Vx minus 0 is equal to 100. So therefore Vx is equal to 100 volt. Right? So Vx is equal to 100 volt. Similarly, see here, I am assuming this as a node voltage Y. See here carefully. So Vx minus 0 is equal to 40. So therefore Vy is equal to 40 volt. So therefore Vy is equal to 40 volt. So now Vx and Vy we already know. Now we need to find the voltage across this resistance R. Oh, the voltage across this resistance R is Vx minus Vy. So let me assume this is a positive, this is a negative. So the current always goes from higher potential to lower potential. So this is higher potential, this is lower potential. So the current will go like this, in this direction, in this direction. So Vxy is equal to Vx minus Vy. 100 minus 40 means 60 volt. 100 minus Y is 60 volt. See, out of 4 nodes, 3 node voltages are already known. One is 0 volt, other is 100 volt, and the other is 40 volt. So there only is only one unknown voltage, which is this node voltage. Let me assume that node voltage as Vp. Let me assume that node voltage as Vp, right? So I need to figure out the value of the node voltage Vp. See, I am writing a nodal analysis at across this voltage Vp, right? By nodal analysis, Na means nodal analysis. I am assuming all the currents are leaving this node, right? All the currents are leaving this node. See here, Vp minus 0 by 2. So Vp minus 0 by 2 plus. This branch is finished, right? So Vp minus Vx. Vx is 100. So Vp minus 100 by 40. So Vp minus 100 by 40. 14, right? 14. Plus, these two values are finished. So we need to write the KCL for this one. So Vp minus Vy by 1. So by Vy is how much? 40. So Vp minus Vy is 40 by 1 is equal to 0. So this is one equation with only one unknown. So after simplifying this, we will get Vp is equal to 30 volt. So the voltage across this node is 30. So by this, all the four node voltages are already known. One is 0, other is 100, this is 40, and this is 30 volt. All the node voltages are finished. So now we have to remove these directions so that it will be easy for us to do the more calculations easily. Other calculations easily. See here. Now, in order to find the value of R, we know the voltage across the resistance, which is Vxy. And if we know the value of the current, then the value of resistance can be easily figured out by R is equal to V by I. So we need to figure out the value of I. That is our main agenda now. Then only we can figure out the value of the resistance R. So in order to find the value of current I need to write the KCL at this junction. Whether you can write KCL at this junction or whether you can write KCL at this junction. You can write KCL at any of this one junction, then we can easily figure out the value of I. So let me construct this junction to write the value of the KCL. See, by KCL, this is the current I write entering, and this is also current entering. So let me assume here also the current is entering into the node. The current, this one, this higher potential Vp minus Vy by 1. So Vp is how much? 30. So 30 by KCL. This is KCL at this junction, right? KCL at the junction at Vy. KCL at junction. KCL at junction Vy. Inside. The sum of incoming currents is 0. The incoming currents is Vp minus Vy by 1. So but Vp is 30. 30 minus 40. 30 minus 40 by 1 plus the current here is already given in the question, 5 ampere. So plus 5 plus the another current is plus I. So I is equal to 0. If you solve this one, you will get I is equal to 5 ampere. Right? After solving this equation, we will get I is equal to 5 ampere. We will get I is equal to 5 ampere. Now, we need to figure out the value of the resistance R. So, we know the voltage across the resistor, which is Vxy is equal to 60, and we know the current in the resistor, which is 5 ampere. Now, we need to figure out the value of self. So, since by the Ohm's law, Vxy is equal to I into R. You know Vxy. Vxy is how much? 60 is equal to I is 5. So, R. R we need to figure out. So, R is equal to 12 ohms. Right? So, after all this procedure, we have figured out our main aim, which is figure out the value of resistance R. So, therefore, R is equal to 12 ohm. So, now we will move forward in order to do the another problem. This problem is very easy, but even then, we will do it so that the other friends who doesn't know this concept can easily understand it. If you know this type of concepts, then even then, please listen so that it will become revision for you. The question number is 28. This question, in this circuit, we need to find the value of the voltage E. In this circuit, we need to find the value of the voltage, which is a voltage source. We need to find the value of E. And this question is given in the gate 2004 for 2 marks. So now, see here, this is the current source. The value of this current source is 1 ampere. And in the question, they are given, in this branch, there is a current of 2 ampere. This is the current source. In this, the current is 1 ampere. And in this branch, there is a 2 ampere. So, if this is a 1 ampere, so we can know, here also there is a 1 ampere current. Here also there is a current of 1 ampere. So, if here it is 2 ampere, the current goes 2 ampere. 2 ampere, 2 ampere. So, here also 2 ampere. So, now, we have to figure out the value of the current in this branch, in this 6 ohm. Let me assume the value of this current is I ampere. So, by applying the KCL across this node, let me assume the node is A. So, by applying the KCL across at this node A, sum of incoming currents is equal to sum of outgoing currents. The incoming currents are 1 ampere and the 2 amperes, and the outgoing current is I ampere. So, by KCL, sum of incoming currents is 1 plus 2 is equal to sum of outgoing currents. Outgoing current is I. So, therefore, I is equal to 3 ampere. So, the current in this 6 ohm branch is 3 ampere. The current in 6 ohm branch is 3 ampere. We need to find the value of the voltage source E. See here, let me do a KVL. By KVL, this is a KVL which I am going through in this loop. I am walking. Let me assume I am here, I am standing here. I am walking around this loop. Before doing that, first we have to mark the plus minus signs. So it is plus minus, which is already given. Current always goes from higher potential to lower potential. So current is going from this, from right to left. So this side is higher potential and this side is lower potential. Similarly, the current is going from up to bottom, right? So this side is positive and this side is negative. So the upper part is positive and the lower part is negative. So now, after marking all these polarities, now I am eligible to walk around this loop, right? So if I go around this loop, first I am encountering minus. From minus to positive, when I walk, there is a potential rise. So by KVL, whenever there is a potential rise, take it as positive. So plus E. After walking from here to here, see, again I am walking from high potential to low potential. So there is a potential drop. So whenever there is a potential drop, take it as minus. So how much is the voltage? Current into voltage. Current is 2 ampere and the ohm is 6 ohm. So 2 into 6, 12. So minus 2 ampere. So I crossed two elements, which are voltage source and the resistance. Now one more element is there, right? So I am going from high potential to lower potential. High potential to lower potential, there is a voltage drop. So there is a voltage drop. How much voltage drop? It is a product of the voltage and the current. It is a product of resistance and the current. 6 ohm and I. I is how much? 3 ampere. So 6 into 3, 18. So minus 18. Because of this potential drop, it is 0. So now minus 12 minus 18 is minus 13. So if I move this term to the right side, it will become E is equal to 30 volt. This is our aim. We figure the value of the voltage E. Suppose we will do some more extension to find what is the voltage across this 1 ohm. So that across the current source 1 ampere. Suppose in the question they given to find the what is voltage V. V means this is the voltage. Actually this is not given in the question, but let us do. Let us calculate this one voltage. It may be given in the next exams, in some other exams. So let us do this one calculation. So how to do it? The same manner. Again, we have to do the KVL. In this loop, we will write a KVL. See here, we are going from low potential to high potential. So there is a rise in voltage plus V. This is a KVL. I am writing the KVL. See here, from plus to minus. Always current goes from high potential to low potential. So as I am walking from high potential to low potential, there is a potential drop. So minus 1 into 10. So means 10. And here, from plus to minus, there is a potential drop. So 6 into I. I is how much? 3 ampere. So 6 into 3 is minus 18. So minus 18 is equal to 0. So I have found a closed loop. Closed loop. So now we need to figure out the value of V. So V is equal to 28. So finally, we figure out the value of E is how much? 30 volt. And the V is how much? 28. So by this problem, we understood how to calculate the value of voltage E and another voltage is V across the voltage source. So now we will move forward in order to solve the new problem, which is 29th. So in this question, this is a circuit. Here it is a current source. This is a current source. This is a resistor, inductor, and capacitor. These are the admittance. Admittance means inverse of the impedance. These are the values which are given for the resistor, inductance, capacitance. These are the admittance values. And the voltage across the parallel branch is also given in the question. And our main aim in this example is to figure out the value of the current I. So what is the value of the current I? We need to figure out through this example. So let me tell you some concept before doing this problem. See, this is a parallel, right? This is a parallel circuit because all the elements are connected in the parallel. So in parallel circuit, the net impedance is equal to sum of reciprocals of the individual impedance values. So let me consider this as Z1 impedance, Z2 impedance and Z3 impedance. So 1 by Z1 plus 1 by Z2 and 1 by Z3. Right? So now the reciprocal of impedance is admittance. So the reciprocal of net impedance is net admittance is equal to this is the impedance. Z1 is the impedance of the resistor. So the reverse of the impedance is wire. Means admittance of resistor plus similarly Z2 is the impedance of the inductor. So 1 by Z2. So 1 by Z2 is the 1 by Z2 is the admittance of the inductor. Means wire. Similarly, Z3 is the impedance of the capacitor. So the reciprocal of impedance is the admittance. So the admittance of the capacitor. So therefore, the net admittance is the sum of the individual admittance. See here, V is equal to I Z into net. This is the whole impedance. This is the current and this is the voltage. So here they are taken as V is a voltage. So let me consider this is also E. It is just a notation, right? So where the value of I. So I is equal to E by Z net. So I already told you 1 by Z net is admittance net, right? So E into Y net. Right? So we want to figure the value of I. So I is equal to E into Y net. So I is equal to E into Y net. We know the value of E is 10 angle 0. Y net is sum of individual, means 0.5 minus J1.5 plus J0.3. So now we can figure out the value of I. After doing the simplification, we will get I is equal to 5 minus J12 amperes. This is the value of the current which we get after doing the simplification from this circuit. So we now figure out the value of I. I is equal to 5 minus J12. Now we will move forward to solve the other question, which is the last question of this video lecture. And this question, there is a current I of t. This current waveform is given in the figure. This current waveform is given in the figure, which passes through this. This is a practical inductor, means it has resistance and it has ideal inductors. An ideal inductor will not have any resistors. But a practical inductor. But a practical inductor will have some resistance and inductors. But a pure inductor will not have any resistance. So here in the question, he is mentioning that there is a practical inductor, means there is a resistance and there is an ideal inductance. And this question is given in the GATE 2003 for 1 mark. And we need to figure out the value of the energy absorbed by the practical inductor. We need to find out the value of the energy absorbed by the practical inductor. Actually, this question is only 1 mark. But I am going to tell you in detailed procedure. I am going to solve this question in detailed procedure. So it may take around 10 minutes. So please kindly be patient and understand the concept. So here we need to figure out the value of the energy absorbed by the practical inductor. See here, the resistor. Suppose some amount of energy is given to this circuit. So always the property of resistor is to dissipate the energy. And this is an ideal inductor. The whole combination is a practical inductor, but this individual is an ideal inductor. An ideal inductor will always absorb the energy. It will never dissipate the energy, but it will always absorb the energy. And the property of the resistor is to dissipate the energy. Here, the energy absorbed by the practical inductor. So therefore, the energy absorbed by the practical inductor is equal to the energy dissipated by the resistor and the energy absorbed by the ideal inductor. Let me consider the energy dissipated by the practical by the resistor is E1, and let me consider the energy absorbed by the ideal inductor is E2. So E1 is equal to, let you write, E1 is equal to energy absorbed by the resistor, and E2 is equal to E2 is equal to energy absorbed by the ideal inductor. So we know the value of the energy is that energy is a function of, is a product of power and power into time, right? Power into time is a function of power. It's a product of power into time, right? So we need to find the value of the energy absorbed by practical inductor during this time period from 0 to 4. From 0 to 4, we need to figure out the value of the energy absorbed by the practical inductor. So energy is equal to power into time. So energy dissipated, energy absorbed from 0 to t, right? So let me ask, it's an integral. So p into t. From 0, t is equal to 0. Some time let me t cancel as a t. We know power is equal to, it's a product of voltage and current. Let me consider this as a voltage V, V of t. Right? The net voltage is V of t. The voltage across the resistor is, let me consider it as Vr of t. And similarly, across the ideal inductor, it is Vl of t. So by KVL, V of t is equal to Vr of t plus Vl of t. So by KVL, V of t is equal to Vr of t plus Vl of t. So power is equal to voltage into current, right? So integration of t is equal to 0 to t. So V of t into I of t into dt. Here it is a power into time. Let me consider as a dt because we are calculating the total energy dissipated from 0 to capital T. So power into small dt. See here, V of t is equal to Vr of t plus Vl of t. So if we keep this equation inside, we can write like this finally. T is equal to 0 to t Vr of t into I of t dt plus t is equal to 0 to t Vl of t I of t dt, right? Just keep this here, keep this expression inside and keep the integral into two parts, we will get like this. Separate the integral into two parts, we will get finally the expression of the energy absorbed by the inductor. So we need to let, this is the energy absorbed by the resistor. So this is E1 and this is energy. E1 is the energy dissipated by the resistor and this is the energy absorbed by the ideal inductor. So this is E2. Right? So we need to find E1, we need to find E2. After doing the summation, we will get the value of the answer A. So first we need to find the value of E1. So our aim is to find the value of E1. In our first case, we will find E1 and then we will find the value of E2. See here, current expression. So current has two lines, two straight lines. One is a like a straight line, like a ramp signal, and the other has a straight line. So we need to find the equation of I of t. So I of t is equal to slope. How much is the slope? 6/2. 6/2 means 3. So 3 into length, y is equal to mx. Slope, m is slope. Slope is how much here? 6/2, 3. Your x axis is the time, so 3t. In the duration, 0 to t. So 0 to t less than or equal to 2 seconds. Similarly, we need to find the value of the expression of this one. It is 6 ampere, right? 6 ampere. From 2 to less than t less than or equal to 4 seconds. So from 2 to 4 seconds, the expression of the current is 6 ampere. From 0 to 2 seconds, the expression of current is 3 ampere. So finally, we figured the I of t expression. So now we have to find the value of Vr of t. First, you have to find E1, right? So Vr is equal to, Vr of t is equal to I of t into R, right? So in place of Vr of t, keep I of t into R. So it will become E is equal to integration of t is equal to 0 to t. It will become, from 0 to t, I square t into R, right? I square of t into R. Here, current expression is 2. From 0 to 2 seconds, it is 3t. And from 2 to 4, it is 6. So we need to, as per the time, we need to write the equation. So similarly, from t is equal to 0 to 2, the expression of current is 3t. So keep here 3t. creating whole square. The value of the resistor is given, 1 ohm. 1 ohm plus. From we need to find actually T2 from T is equal to 0 to 4. So T is equal to 0 to 2 is finished and the remaining time is duration is 2 to 4. So 2 to 4. So T is equal to 2 to T is equal to 4. T is equal to 2 to 4 seconds. The expression of 2 to 4 seconds is 6 ampere, right? So in place of y of t keep 6. So 6 square, 36. So let me write here 6 square and keep r is equal to 1. If you do the integration and if you do the calculation, finally you will get answer as 96 joule. So finally here you will get answer as 96 joule after doing the calculation E1. After finding the value of E1, now we found out the value of E1. Now we need to find the value of E2. In E2. So we need to find the value of E2. So same here. E2 is equal to VL of T. VL of T means how much? We know the value of VL of T is equal to the voltage across the inductor is L into di of T by dt, right? Di of T by dt. L into di of T by dt. So here 0 to T is equal to 0 to 4 seconds. We need to 4 seconds, right? From 0 to 4 seconds. So VL of T is L di of T by dt into dt. And that's the current rate, current I of t. So you have to write current I of t. Let me write again. Here it is I of t into dt. See here, the current expression is different for 2 seconds 0 to 2 and 2 to 4. So we need to write as per the expression of current. So t is equal to 0 to 2 seconds L di of t by dt into I of t dt plus t is equal to 2 to 4 L di of t by dt into I of t into dt. See here, 0 to t is how much? 2. So t is equal to 0 to 2 L is 2. Di of dt is how much? 3, right? 3. I of t 3t plus t is equal to 2 to 4 here di of dt 6, differentiation of 6 is 0, so the total answer will become 0. So no need to do this one. So no need to do this part, means it means this part becomes 0. So you don't have to do this part again. So after doing the integration part, if you do the integration, you will get answer as 36 joule. 36 joule. So we got the value of E1 as 96 and E2 as 36. Therefore, our answer is to pair to the value of E. E is equal to E1 plus E2. E1 is how much? 96 plus 36 is equal to 132 joules. So our answer is 132 joules. Therefore, E is equal to 132 joules is our answer. So I have did the last question, 13th question. If you did not understood that question, again go back and see the that particular question 30 again. You will understand it finally. Okay. Now, in the previous two lectures, I have seen the comments. Some of them told that the voice is not so clarity. The fact is I don't have a microphone right now because in this lockdown I was unable to get that microphone. In coming few days I am going to purchase that microphone so that the audio will be very clarity. But still I want to continue the lectures without microphone up to that time. So please be patient. I'm going to speak very loud so that the phone microphone, the microphone inside the phone can catch my voice. I'm going to increase my volume. So up to that time, please bear with me before I purchase that microphone. If you like the content in this video lecture, then please like and share and subscribe my channel so that you will get motivation to do more these type of lectures which are useful for the student community. So it is your duty to like and share and subscribe this channel. We will produce high quality lectures like this in the coming days also. After few days, we are thinking to plan a new playlist of subject wise. If you want any subject as highest preference, then please comment so that if it is as per our schedule, we will teach that subject as a first priority. If it is any hard subject like machines, like power system, like power electronics, then please tell us which subject it needs to be teached in the highest priority. If you let us know in the comment section, if it is as per our schedule, then we will compulsorily teach that subject as a first priority. In this lockdown, stay home, stay safe, and be with your family, and spend these days with highest preparation. If it is a competitive examinations, prepare nicely and don't waste your time. Time is very valuable. Thank you so much for listening this lecture.